Harper Teen and Harper Audio present And Break the Pretty Kings by Lena Jeong. Performed by Greta Jeong. Dedicated to Emmeline and all oldest daughters everywhere. Chapter 1. Summoning fire was easy. Mirae had been studying the manipulation of the four elements her whole life. Scorching the woman in front of her, however, was something she hadn't managed even once in the past 3 months. Nevertheless, Mirae raised a hand to the heavens as if pulling fire from the sun. A small white-hot orb appeared in her palm. Before its sharp heat could blister her skin, Mirae lobbed it with all her strength at her opponent. Captain Jia, head of the palace guards, swatted Mirae's orb into wisps of harmless steam, then glanced down at her barely smoking wrist guard.
"Have you considered a career in the sauna industry, Gongju?"
she asked wryly.
"You seem much more adept at making people sweat than burning them alive."
Mirae wiped her brow, careful not to pull any more hair loose. The palace women were starting to get suspicious about the long morning walks that kept ruining all their hard work, and with tonight's pre-coronation ceremony only hours away, they would be loath to redo her hair completely. It was a blessing that Captain Jia, at least, could be trusted to keep Mirae's morning trainings a secret. The last thing she needed was for a crowd of gawking royals to gather on the field, judging for themselves whether their crown princess was truly ready to assume her birthright, to stand between Sola and ultimate ruin, no matter the cost. It certainly didn't help that her mother's recent illness, a generational madness that would incapacitate Sola's queen all too soon, meant Mirae needed to prove her skills faster than any of her ancestors ever had. Tonight would determine whether all her work had paid off. Mirae blew into her hot red palms, willing herself to focus, but her mind wandered to thoughts of her grandmother, whom she had adored more than anything. The last time Mirae saw her, her Wei Harmony had been standing at the dragon gates to the palace, eyes turned white hot with uncontrollable madness. The price all her ancestors paid for being gods-touched guardians against Sola's ancient enemy.
"You were not born to end up like me," she'd said. "I see your destiny, my little golden snake, and no one can take it from you. Never forget the dragons in your blood."
Mirae raised her hands for another attack, feeling her heartbeat slow as she willed her body to stay calm and focused, the way a crown princess was supposed to be. Then, Captain Jia's words registered, and Mirae snorted.
"A sauna? I suppose it's good to have a backup plan in case I fail tonight, assuming I survive."
Captain Jia waved Mirae's words away, as easily as she did her fireballs.
"The Gongju, I know, fails at nothing. When faced with dire odds, she'll succeed. Creatively, if she must."
Mirae sighed.
"You're never letting the flying turtle incident go, are you?" "The flying turtle must never be forgotten." "It was one time." "Two, if you count the talking turtle you enchanted on my birthday." "What? I thought you liked turtles." "You've trained with me for years, and that's what you choose to remember?"
Mirae had been studying sacred bone magic, the ability to wield all three of Sola's magic systems, a birthright that belonged only to Solan queens and their heirs, her whole life. But since her mother's illness, she had postponed all her other studies while Captain Jia did her best to advance Mirae's talents in her own field of expertise. Jade witchery. The first magic system Mirae would be tested in that night. Thanks to Captain Jia, Mirae's skills had improved to the level of a woman with years more experience than she had. The Jade Witch prodigy was herself the youngest captain ever appointed to the Wanhua, the palace guards, and was rumored to be on track to become general of Sola's army. But both Mirae and the young captain sorely missed the days when sneaking off entailed hanging out with Mirae's brothers by the river, instead of attacking each other with all four elements, as if the fate of the peninsula depended on it. Of course, despite all her new skills, Mirae occasionally still needed to rely on other techniques to achieve the results everyone expected of her. She couldn't help but chuckle now at the memory Captain Jia had brought up.
Who knew turtles were so chatty?
But Captain Jia's face had sobered. Mirae followed her gaze across the secluded training field and felt her own body fall still. The royal palanquin was approaching from the west, a blood-red box looming over the shoulders of 10 impassive servants. Not even the cheery yellow drapes or black canopy for cooling could draw Mirae's eyes away from the beaded curtain that hid the woman inside, her mother, Sola's enchanted queen. The woman everyone expected Mirae to replace, years earlier than any other crown princess had attempted the trial of the gods. Mirae turned back to the captain.
What is she doing here?
The physician said taking long walks would benefit Her Majesty, Captain Jia said. It looks like she's taking a page out of your book when it comes to loose interpretations.
She should be resting.
Mirae looked nervously toward the tree line to the south. In truth, she was worried that her mother's increasingly unstable powers would tamper with her own carefully honed magic. Today of all days needed to go uneventfully. The sacred bone oracles were already in the forest's depths, setting up the mysterious trial of the gods.
Do you think she needs to speak to me?
Mirae asked, careful not to glance back at the palanquin, lest she expose her nervousness. Captain Jia shook her head.
I doubt Her Majesty will get too close. She knows what happens when your sacred bone powers interact.
A few weeks ago, there had been an incident. Mirae's mother was found sleepwalking in the ancestral shrine, lighting paintings of past queens on fire. Mirae had been roused from bed and used a soothing Maum illusion to draw her mother out. But her spell had waned too quickly, her skills in Sola's second magic system too weak to compete with her mother's madness. Her mother's delusions ended up coming back with a vengeance that resulted in the rest of the building catching fire, nearly taking Mirae along with it. After that, the council members of the Huabek had decreed that Mirae's mother was no longer fit to rule, and Mirae's Hangsok ceremony would be scheduled for the next full moon, whether she was ready for it or not. It was now only hours away, and Mirae could hardly call herself prepared.
Gongju!
Captain Jia pulled Mirae back into the present and gave her an encouraging nod.
Stay focused and show Her Majesty what you can do. Light me on fire.
Mirae nodded and held her palms in front of her, readying them for magic. She took a moment to study Captain Jia's defenses, trying to puzzle out a fresh plan of attack. The captain's ensemble was the same as it always was. Over a thick red tunic that signified her status, she wore scale armor, which afforded her more mobility than Mirae liked when they were facing off. Around her waist was tied a blood-red sash, embroidered with gold peonies that signaled her rank as captain of the palace guard. The only weak spot Mirae could hope to exploit was the one she'd been trying and failing to set on fire all morning.
I don't suppose you'd be willing to stand still and make this easy for me?
Captain Jia snorted.
I'm not a campfire. Pretend I'm an enemy assassin from Chosan.
Mirae held back a retort about how a Chosan assassin wouldn't have magic. Its use was forbidden in their land, Instead, she raised a hand to the sky, drawing heat from the sun yet again. Once it had gathered into a sphere in her palms, Mirae hurled the fireball at her opponent, realizing too late that her weary arm had aimed the attack poorly. Captain Jia blocked the clumsy spell by simply raising her hand. Green flames sprouted out of her palm like dancing petals and easily devoured Mirae's orange ball, lobbed artlessly like a rotting persimmon. Mirae clenched her fists, using the sharp pain of her budding blisters to drown out the fear she couldn't afford to let anyone see. Again, she reached her arm toward the sun, her mind willing her palms to recreate the heavenly orb. As soon as the new fireball was formed, Mirae hurled it without warning. Captain Jia's warrior response kicked in. Quick as a bamboo switch, she raised her palm, green with fire. Too late, she realized that Mirae had released a second spell, a blast of air she'd been secretly preparing. Mirae hadn't even had to blink. The only thing easier than summoning fire was channeling wind. Focusing on the morning-chilled tip of her nose, she had drawn that brisk feeling into her hands, cooling her skin with a sharp burst of icy air. Then, with barely a thought, she had turned that small nip of wind into a narrow gale, strong enough to rush past the surprised captain, forcing the flames in her palm to fly backward. They slipped between her fingers, setting first her brace on fire, and then her whole arm. Mirae smiled, knowing the captain's jade fire wouldn't harm the flesh of its maker, though the same couldn't be said for her clothes. Captain Jia calmly brushed her free hand down her burning arm, extinguishing every lick of green flame.
"I suppose you're proud of that one."
"I was being creative," Mirae said. "You called it my greatest skill."
"I don't recall describing it that way."
"Well, it got you nice and toasty all the same."
Captain Jia held out her hands, inspecting them for damage.
"See, this is why you should build the sauna of Sola. Your fire never actually hurts anyone, which is a great selling point."
Mirae grimaced.
"That's a terrible name for my future business."
"You're opening a sauna?"
asked a familiar voice from behind Mirae.
"Then you'll need someone to manage your finances, since you tend to treat math like an elusive mystic art."
Mirae whirled around and beamed at her older brother, Minho, who must have remained hidden behind the palanquin to surprise her. She was glad he had been able to witness her fireball success.
"Aren't you supposed to be keeping Father and Hongbin out of trouble?"
"An impossible task."
Minho gave Mirae and Captain Jia a pained look, not bothering to hide his casualness with a captain around his sister. As his most trusted confidant, Mirae knew everything about their secret relationship.
"The Chosan dignitaries just arrived, and you know how annoying Father and our little brother are when they start trying to prove he's secretly a Kumiho."
"At least they've moved on from Tokkebi. Hongbin's attempts to trick the dignitary into a wrestling match last year were getting disturbingly creative."
Mirae patted her older brother's shoulder.
"I know what you're thinking, Orabani, but no, we can't ask the Chosan dignitary to leave, even though no one's happy he's here. A representative of our sovereign state must witness the succession of a new queen and swear fealty to the throne."
"I know."
Minho glanced back at their mother's palanquin, which waited several yards away in the open field like a ruby lantern containing Sola's once brightest light.
"There's just something about his face that makes me wish a Kumiho would actually come eat him. If anyone was going to bring back Chosan's history of thwarting the trial of the gods and trying to unleash our diabolic enemy, it would be him."
"He's no threat, Taegundaegam. I promise," Captain Jia said, then bowed before crossing her arms over her chest.
With a royal palanquin nearby, she had resumed using full honorifics and making proper obeisance to her lieges, just as she did in public. The dignitary can't even look outside his chamber without an entourage of my best guards interrogating his intentions. There will be no sabotaging of the Sangsok ceremony tonight.
You don't have to be so formal, Jia, as if we're under surveillance too,
Minho said with a grin.
I'm pretty sure my mother already suspects we're more than friends.
Captain Jia blushed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.